You had studied the conditional execution of statements at your home. This is one problem that you would have solved on how to find and print the largest of two given numbers. So if two numbers are given, this is one program which could solve that problem. The numbers are A and B. I declare int A and B. I want to find out the largest of the two, so I declare max, in which I will store the largest value. I have the standard message output saying give me two numbers. I input two numbers A and B, and I have a simple conditional execution. If A is greater than B, then I allocate A to max, else I allocate B to max. I know at the end of this execution, max will contain the larger of the two. What will happen if both numbers are same? His answer is anyone would go to max. Anyone can go to max in such a situation is the correct answer. But this particular logic that is implemented, so if A is greater than B, it will not be true if A is equal to B. Therefore, this statement will not be executed. And the second statement will be, else statement will be. Is that clear? So this is a state implementation. Now, you can also write this in a slightly better fashion in this way. Set to be an indented program where you indent the if part and the else part so that it is clearly visible to people as to what action you take during the stage when the condition is true or what action you take when the condition is false. In this particular instance, it does not really matter because there is a single statement that you are executing in either case. But suppose you had four or five statements on this side and four or five statements on the other side, then they would not be very clearly decipherable unless you put this kind of in. All right. Now, this is a problem I would like you to solve. Find maximum largest of three numbers, A, B, and C. The declaration is given. Int A, B, C, max. I have taken the plain input A, B, and C. At the end of this program, I expect that your program would have found out the right value of max. Putting this C out, largest number is max and L, return 0. Incidentally, you should become familiar with this style of programming where you don't end up writing each and every statement for every program. For example, hash include statement or using statement, int main statement. These are going to be standard statements in any program. It is useful to know how to correctly write the spellings and semicolons, etc. But it is stupid to keep on doing this for every program. So that is the reason why you would have skeleton of programs, if not anybody else's, your own program. So you can copy your existing program, remove the unwanted things, and start writing a new program so that you save on typing time, because your time is important. So assume that these statements are already written. Incidentally, in many of our exams and quizzes, the questions would be of this type, where the structure of a program would be given and you would be expected to write a portion in between using the declarations that have been made and producing the result that is going to be printed. So it's a simple extension of the previous problem, except that I don't want people to do only mental calculation. I want each notebook to have exactly all the statements which are required to compute max, given the three numbers whose largest value should be assigned to max. So write down all the statements that you would within this region. Come on. Everybody has to write a program, and then I will tell you what next to be done. Have you discussed with each other and convinced who is right, who is wrong? So now raise hands where there was a disagreement amongst people that one of the programs was not correct. Disagreement. Raise your hands. None. All had an agreement. All right. Now I have two answers from two of your friends. They could not discuss this because I commandeered their copies before they could, but I would like you to see these programs. All right, this is one program. There is an obvious error. Our friend was over enthusiastic and he started writing the complete program. The instructions were, please do not write int ABC, C in, etc., etc. Please do not write C out. You write only that structure, nothing else. I will tell you why this is important. Suppose in a quiz, you are asked to input a text which will be the portion like this which you have to write. And suppose you write int ABC max. Now the way we will automatically test your submission will be, we will take our structure, insert your text in between and let the compiler run that program. What will happen? Int A comma B comma C max in my structure, again int A comma B comma. And compiler will go crazy. Of course you will get zero. So the first thing, follow instructions very carefully. All right. But barring that, would you agree that this program will find out max correctly? No. Somebody is saying no. All right. So first, let us examine this program as is. It says if A is greater than B and A is greater than C, then max is equal to A. So if A is indeed the larger of all the three, so A is not equal to B, A is not equal to C, is very obvious if this is true. A is truly the largest. So A will come out to be the maximum. If it is not so, that means A is either equal to B or less than B, or A is either less than or equal to C. In such conditions you come here and you examine whether B is greater than C. If B is greater than C, he is saying max is equal to B, else he is saying max is equal to C. So now you can raise your objection. What is the input for which this program will not work? All right, let us take his suggestion. He says all are equal. Say 7, 7, 7. Now if all are equal, does it matter which one of them gets assigned to, does it matter which one of them gets assigned to max? They are all same values. Is one 7 better than the second 7? Or is the third 7 so useless that it cannot be assigned? They are all 7. So it doesn't matter. What was the other case that you are trying to point out? Look at what is observed. Suppose they are all 7. If A greater than B and A greater than C, is this condition true? No. So this will be false. So I will come out to the else part. Right? In the else part I say, if B greater than C, max is equal to B. Else, max is equal to C. So max is equal to C is being executed. B will not be greater than C, B will be equal to C. Remember, this else will be executed once you come here to this else. He was poor fellow under the impression that if all three are equal, max is not getting assigned any value at all. Actually, I don't think our friend had really thought that deep, but he is lucky, his program is working fine. Syntax error. Here is another effort. If A greater than B, within that he is checking if A is greater than C, max is equal to A, else max is equal to C. If A is not greater than B, then else if B is greater than C, max is equal to B, else max is equal to C. Will this work? Anyway, we have not discussed this, but generally you believe that this program will also work. All right. Now, here is a point that I am trying to make. Almost all of you, there might be some exceptions, we have not seen the copies, almost all of you are actually trying to follow this flowchart. Checking A is greater than B. If this is true, you are checking if B is greater than C, etc., etc. Right? This is the general approach. Now, try to solve this problem. Numbers are A, B, C, D, E. Int A, comma B, comma C, comma D, comma E, semicolon. No, max, semicolon. And now, find out the largest of A, B, C, D, E. So, first thing for 2 minutes, because you will now have to say if A greater than B, then if B greater than C, then if C greater than D, and else C less than B, A, whatever, whatever. All right. The point being made is, can you not, without even writing the program, can you not guess that this approach is going to take quite some time to write a program? And this approach is therefore likely to take about half an hour of your time, after which there is a 99.9% probability that the program will not work correctly. Now, suppose I ask you something else. I am writing a series of 5 numbers. Let us see how quickly you, as human beings, find out the largest. What is the largest? Ah. This took much less than half an hour, right? What did you do? Did you compare each number with every other number? No. What you were doing, I'll tell you what you were doing. In your mind, you were sort of separately remembering the largest number encountered so far. As I was writing the number, so you had this kind of location in your mind, where the moment I wrote 5, you said 5 is the largest. The moment second number came, 7, 5, it is larger than 5. So you sort of erased it and wrote 7 here. Then when I wrote the third number, you said, 14 is larger than 7. So you wrote 14. When I wrote the fourth number, 2, said ignore. When I wrote the fifth number, 12, ignore. Every time you were comparing the number that I was writing with what you had in mind. So in fact, the moment I finished writing 12, your answer was ready. Now when you can do things with such simple, elegant logic, why is it that you think that to write a C++ program, you have to think in such a complex way to eat it like this and so on and so forth? That's the point. The point I'm making is, you were all guided by the fact that there was a two-way decision-making box. So your premise was that somehow you have to start by comparing two numbers first. Now once you do that, you're doomed. Because you have to compare whatever was the larger amongst the two with something else. And then, like what do you call it? Like a big tree, you know, it will keep growing. And if you are not convinced that you can do it in less than half an hour or more than half an hour, imagine I give you 24 numbers. The rest of the semester you will be writing that program. Not worth it. Now, how do you implement your algorithm? You knew it before coming to IIT. That is how you solved all such problems in life. Imagine now that this is max. What did you do? You read all the numbers. You arbitrarily started with max equal to A. You put that number there. Now you compared the second number with the current value of max. Is that number larger than max? Then you said max equal to B. Is C larger than max? Max equal to C. If D larger than max equal to D. If E larger than max equal to E. And whatever comes out is max. Now you see, even if I give 23 numbers, you will say, 23 bar likhega. But it won't be a 1,000-line program. So please remember to apply your common sense with which you have been solving such problems earlier in life. Here is a solution you may wish to note just for your record. But do you agree that this will solve the problem? And you agree that this has no complex logic? And that this can be extended for any number of numbers? Now let me ask you another question. I am trying to extend this logic to see whether if instead of 23 numbers, I had 50 numbers, I can extend the same logic. Suppose, for instance, that my job is just to find out the maximum value and print it. I don't care what are the individual values of A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, etc., etc. In that case, is it really necessary for me to use 7 variable locations if I want to find out the maximum of 7 given numbers? So what is the minimum number of locations that I must have to find out the max seven given numbers. Has everybody got it? No. So let me describe that method. I say int n and max. N is any number. I have read the first number. I am remembering at max. This is the trick. I am reading the second number and putting it in the same location for n. That is because whatever I had to do with the previous number, I have already done. So I can afford to forget it. I am reusing that location. But now, to find max, I will have to do something. What is that? You agree that this will find out the larger of the given numbers. Now, can I repeat this 5 times? Can I not repeat it 25 times? Please note that the advantage of saving memory locations is incidental. There is a far greater advantage in writing my program in this fashion, because now I know that array, this thing seems to be repeating again and again and again. Now suppose I have to find out the largest of 500 numbers. If I had a mechanism to say, hey boss, C++, do this 100 times or 500 times, will you not get the maximum? That instruction should look something like, repeat the following 500 times. Fortunately, C++ has such instructions, and you will see them in the next week. Now you will notice that a very large computational problem can actually be addressed by writing a program. And trick in those iterative solutions will be how quickly you can identify program instructions which can be repeatedly executed. You cannot repeatedly execute instructions if one instruction say, if A greater, max greater than B, another says max greater than C, third one says max greater than D, there is nothing to be repeated. All right. Now solve this problem. Write a program to input 5 numbers as before, A, B, C, D, E, or A, whatever way you want. But I would like you to write a program which reads 5 numbers A, B, C, D, E, and find out the second largest number. So please ignore the word output the second largest number. You have to find out, you give it another name, call it max 2. So there is a max and there is max 2. You may incidentally also have to find max. But what we want your program to do is find out max 2. This is not a difficult question, but it is not as simple as it looks. Only hint I will give you. And start writing program. I want to write. Please remember the declarations are given. Let me be very specific. You already have this declaration. You have read all the numbers. And what I need for you to find out max 2. You already got a hint. You need not make obscure comparisons between various numbers. Just like you kept a location called max and kept stuffing it with whatever was the latest maximum, you should obviously now keep 2 numbers. One max and the other is max 2, and keep running down the list, comparing appropriately with the current max and current max 2 till you find out correct max 2, right? He is of course not using all A, B, C, D, E numbers. He is reading 1 number, assigning it to max, then he is reading another number. If A is greater than max, then he puts the previous value of max in max 2 and assigns the new value to max. So you would agree that so far he has read two numbers and they are put properly in max and max 2. Now he reads, oh, there is an else clause. If A is not greater than max, that means he has to assume that max is greater and the value of A must go into max 2. So it is these statements which complete the initial assignment of max and max 2. Next, he reads in another number, and to this number he applies exactly the same logic. If this number is greater than max, then the old max becomes max 2 and new number becomes max. If that is not so, then the new number becomes max 2. Is that correct? If A is greater than max, then this assignment is correct. But if A is greater than, not greater than max, does it imply that A is greater than max 2? So this part is something like an initialization. And after that, when he reads the next number, he checks if it is greater than max. If so, then max and A are shifted to max 2 and max respectively. Else, he checks if A is greater than max 2. If so, then A is put into max 2. Otherwise, A is ignored. So he is using the same logic, except that he is using two locations now. He has to write this how many times? I will call this R1. I will call this R2. That is, repeat second time. And then I will call this R3. Unfortunately, he is outputting A. I don't know why. So my problem is with his last statement, C out less A. Whose notebook is this? Very good effort, but you see a small mistake. Luckily for you, in the structure that I had written, C out max and max 2 would have occurred anyway. So you don't lose out on anything. But remember to do it correctly. All right. Here is another effort. If A greater than B, max is equal to A, max 2 is equal to B. Else, max is equal to B, max 2 is equal to A. Simple thing, two numbers are read, depending upon which one is greater, one is assigned here. The next one, C is read. If C is greater than max, then max 2 is made into max and max is assigned the value C. Else, if C is less than max and C is greater than max 2, then max 2 is set to C. Can you see the difference, any difference between this condition checking and the one which we saw previously? Anyway, but you follow, this is the general logic. Here is another effort I have. So if B is greater than max, max is equal to B, else max 2 is equal to B. If C is greater than max, max is equal to C, else max 2 equal to C. Do you think this will work correctly? Many people feel there is a problem. Now the correct thing to do is to execute your program with some input values and at least two or three distinct sets, and at least in one of them you should have duplicate values, same values which are largest, etc., etc. So you don't blindly believe that your program is correct, although it might be correct. Here is another attempt. So our friend has done what any professional would actually do. He has written down a series of values, 10, 20, 40, 20, 10, and actually executed the algorithm, found out what would be the max and max 2 at different stages, and therefore he believes that this algorithm will work. This is the minimal that is expected when you are doing programming practice. Many people believe that you write a program, submit it, end of the matter. If it compiles correctly, that is fine. It does not work that way. And you have to learn to hand execute a program with some sample data. And creating a sample data is itself an art. You must create multiple sets of sample data which will actually exercise different parts of the program. Max equal to A, if B greater than max, max 2 equal to max, max equal to B, will this work? A, B, C, D have been read, max is assigned the value A. If B is greater than max, then max 2 is max and max is equal to B. So the values are shifted appropriate. What it means is, like all of us, he would by this point would assign a value to max 2. However, if B is not greater than max, then what happens? So if B is not greater than max, it will come here and it will assign max equal to B. If B is greater than max, then it will assign max to max 2 and B to max. But if this is not correct, so this is the classic case where somebody wants to execute two instructions if a condition is correct. And if you want to execute two instructions, you must put them like this. Otherwise, they will not be executed. However, if this condition is not correct, then nothing gets assigned to max 2, although you already handled two numbers. So there is some problem here that should be corrected. Here is the last attempt we will look at. So this is the program. If A greater than B, max is equal to A, max 2 equal to B. Else, max is equal to B, max 2 equal to A. It's a very clean way of saying that I will examine the first two numbers and put them appropriately in max and max 2. Having done that, he now looks at C. If C is greater than max, max 2 is equal to max, max is equal to C, obviously, because the max is being replaced, the previous max must become max 2. Else, he examines if C is at least greater than max 2. If so, max 2 is reset to C. Max is anyway decided. Notice that this is something equivalent to initial work, and this is something which is equivalent to a repeatable task. You agree? Now, whatever I have done for C, I will do for D. Whatever I do for D, I will do for E, for F, for G, whatever. You had an example where a friend had used only one number, one variable, and was doing everything using one variable. That is also doable. Everybody understood how these things are to be done. They're not complex things, but you have to be very focused when you think about doing this. If you have to find out the fifth largest number amongst 500 numbers given, now that program would become complex if you write it like this. But as I mentioned, you have the possibility of forcing C++ to repeatedly execute some instructions, and you would be able to find out the fifth largest by using what is known as the nested iteration. We'll discuss these problems later. All right. So this is an exercise. Write a program to input a three-digit number and display the sum of its digits. So please understand, I made a mistake in framing these questions. My questions will in future never show such thing that there is some input and you print something. It's not like that. You actually store that input somewhere, you find out different components, and then you find the answer and then you print it. So let me rephrase this problem. So I am writing in a symbolic notation that all of you are familiar with. However, you know that you can't declare memory locations in C++ with D subscript 3, D subscript 2, etc., etc. So you'll have to give proper names. I will tell you the names for this. So this is the part of the program which is written already. Now I am being very clear in describing that you have to read a number n. You have to read a number n, and then from that number n, you have to find individual values of D3, D2, D1. Please note that these values individually must be between 0 and 9. These are digits. So here is one solution by Aditya. He seems to have written his D1, D2, D3 in a very peculiar fashion, because it appears to be Q1, Q2, Q3 to me, but doesn't matter. I would also like to remind my friend Aditya that when you type on a keyboard, if you type Q, it will come like this, but if you type 1, it will not come like this. It will come like this only. So please remember not to write superscripts and subscripts, because they don't appear in the machine. All right. He reads in the value n. Q1 is equal to n by 100. That will give you what? The first digit, the most significant. Q2 will get you what? N by 10 minus 10 into n by 100. Q3 is equal to n by 10 minus 100 into n by 100 minus 10 into n by 10. Will you get the answers? Aditya, people don't agree with your answer. Please go back and examine. But he has executed something and he seems to have found out the correct answer for the sample data that he has taken. All right, here is another effort by Shivam. He reads in n, calculates D3 as equal to n by 100. I would also like to remind Aditya and others that if you are given a problem which says D1, D2, D3 have specific interpretations, which one is the least significant digit, which one is the most significant digit, is given in the specification, then your program must use the same terminology. Otherwise, it will not be readable and understandable by others, even though it might find the correct solution. So here D3 is found by dividing n by 100. D2 is found by subtracting from n D3 into 100 and then dividing the whole thing by 10. And D1 is found by taking a modulo of 10, of the number 10 n itself, and then these three digits are added. Will this program work correctly? Anybody who says it will not work? It will not work because there is no semicolon. There is a full stop here. Now will it work? Will it work? Ah, everybody says it will work. I have a minor typographical problem. How will I create brackets of different sizes? For example, problem is D3 into 100. Can you spot an error in what he has written? X is not correct, he has to use star. However, the next one, n minus this, now the bracket has become larger. Divided by 10, 10 has gone down. Then there is a bracket which is still larger. Shivam, I have a small question. If I had given you a 10 digit number, how large would be the outermost bracket? So this is, of course, it doesn't matter, because you know that when you type, you will get a bracket of exactly the same size. But it is prudent and useful to remember that and practice writing it like that. Fine. Here is another effort. So Pranjali has solved this problem in this fashion. D1 is equal to n% 10. So n modulo 10 will give her the digit D1. Is that correct? That is because the representation was D3, D2, D1, and D1 was the unit's digit. So this is found correctly. Then simply she finds, she reduces n, she divides n by 10. So the last digit actually vanishes. So now she has a two-digit number. D2 is equal to n modulo 10. Now you will get the last digit of that two-digit number, which is actually the tens digit. She further mutilates n and divides it by 10. So now she has a single digit number. And then she finds out D3 equal to n and finds out S is equal to D1, D2, D3. I have one question, Pranjali. Why are you mutilating my n? Suppose after this time, I wanted to do some computation using n. the value of n will be the 100th digit only. So please leave my n alone. Right. But you can see it's a very clean program. It will work like this. It is not uncommon when you want to write a program like this, where you want to successively reduce a value and you wish to use the reduced value for computations, it is not uncommon to say something like int n temp, etc., and then say temp equal to n and do whatever you wish to do with temp, because temp is your own personal variable. Here's the last one we'll see. This is from Yogesh. So Yogesh declares these numbers, inputs n, calculates D3 as n by 100. He also reduces n by saying n is equal to n minus D3 into 100, calculates D2 as n by 10, calculates D1 as n minus D2 by 10, and finds out the sum. This program will also work. There is one good point here, and that is because S is going to be output, he starts with S equal to 0. He knows that D1, D3, D2 are being computed from N. N is going to be an input value, but S is going to be computed. In general, it's a good idea to initialize your variables. All right, we'll stop at this juncture.